I have bad news.
You're gonna die, clown!
Everyone is going to die. Your best friend, your neighbor, that mean teacher from third grade, Matt Damon.
Just f***ing kill me.
I mean everybody. As big ideas come, it's a hard one to accept, but it's not quite as unpopular as another idea, that you might not need to die. That's the belief fueling the cryonics movement, whose advocates believe that medical science will eventually become so advanced that we can cure all diseases and reverse aging. In the meantime, they're storing the bodies of the deceased in tanks of liquid nitrogen to preserve them until they can be revived at some future date.
Reanimation complete.
Yup. Buckle up. This is On the Fringe, a show about weird ideas that just might change the world.
People have this idea of death as black or white, like a switch had just been flicked. It's more like there's day and there's night, and then there's twilight. It's kind of a blurring.
This is Max Moore, CEO of Alcor, one of the largest cryonics organizations in the world.
Back in 1960, if you stopped breathing, your heart stopped beating, you'd have checked your vitals and just said, oh, this person's dead, and we would have disposed of you. But today we don't do that. We say, this person will be dead if we don't do something. And so we do CPR, defibrillation, and various other treatments, and very often resuscitate the person. So we're making the same point that today, when we say someone's dead, what we really mean is, we don't know what else we can do with today's technology. And the whole point of cryonics is you don't have to rely on today's technology. We can take you into a future where we will have those capabilities. We just have to develop the technology that can repair the damage and restart the system.
Obviously, the challenge here is that we don't yet have this technology. And detractors warn it's not clear we will ever be able to restore those who have been cryogenically frozen. But for cryonic supporters, that misses the point.
My mother and my father-in-law are both in this unit. And my husband is in this unit.
This is Linda Chamberlain. She founded Alcor in 1972, along with her husband Fred, a former engineer at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory.
This is our patient care bay, where we have 153 patients in these capsules. The engineering term for them is DOOR.
So, if you're like me, you're probably wondering how you can do this at home to save some money. But that's a terrible idea. Instead, let's look at how the professionals do it.
There are really three main stages to the cryonics process. The first one being standby stabilization and transport.
We stabilize them to stop the dying process once they've been pronounced clinically dead. Then they're transported to our facility.
The second stage is the surgery.
The patient is brought in through these doors. They're first placed on this operating table, which becomes the capsule that they will be in.
We're going to access blood vessels and remove as much blood and other fluids as we can and replace them with our cryoprotectant solution, a kind of a medical grade antifreeze. And then the final stage really is to cool down and maintain the patient at ultra cold temperatures, in our case, minus 320 Fahrenheit.
It's so cold that the atoms are not vibrating. If they're not moving, changes are not taking place. So they can stay at that temperature for thousands of years if necessary. This is a model of these doors. Think of it as like a giant thermos. If you're looking down inside, around the outside, there are four whole body pods. In the center unit comes out, and we can get five neuro patients.
Neuro patients are Alcor's term of art for heads, as in not attached to a body. Let's unpack that one for a second.
Our goal is to preserve the brain structure more than anything else. I mean, people want to keep the whole body, we preserve that too, but essentially that's basically replaceable. You can replace the rest of the body. We're already regrowing organs and we'll learn how to regenerate limbs and so on. But the brain, you can't replace, that's where you live. So that we have to preserve.
For $200,000, Alcor members can have their entire bodies preserved. But for $80,000, they'll store just your head. The distinction is not just about thrift. Many members think that a society capable of reviving them might also be able to provide them with a new biological or robot body, or a swarm of nanobots. I think that would be kind of fun. So we know what cryonics is and how it works, but what hard evidence exists to suggest it might be plausible?
There is a fair amount of direct scientific evidence that what we're doing under good conditions does in fact preserve the structures that preserve our memories and personality. For instance, we have electron micrograph studies of animal brain tissue that's gone through the same protocol, and you can show that the structures are intact. We've also done a study that was published a year or two ago. It was the first time it's been done with a whole organism, albeit a very simple one. We took C. elegans, this little tiny microscopic worm that's been very well studied in biology. We taught it a very simple task, basically how to find food based on the chemical gradients. And then we cryopreserved it, held it there for a while, rewarmed it, and then tested it against the controls, and were able to demonstrate that it not only came back to life, but retained its memory. There's also a rather dramatic moment where, at first the experimenter thought there was an air bubble that was in there by mistake, but it turns out, actually, after being brought back from cryopreservation, it was pregnant and gave birth to its little babies that went on about their merry way.
We're still far away from being able to say definitively whether the promise of cryonics will pay off. But for its most ardent supporters, it's a bet worth taking.
People are dying, people that we love. For us, the very fact that we can cryopreserve a person, put them into stasis so that no further damage can happen, is a whole lot better than being buried or cremated, and there's no hope of being able to resuscitate you in the future.
I think the metaphor, why cryonics makes sense. You're in an airplane and the pilot told you, we're definitely gonna crash, there's no way out of it. We have these experimental parachutes on board that have never been tested. It may or may not work. You're willing to stay in the plane till it crashes or just jump out without one, or you can take one of the parachutes. What would you do? If you put it in that context, the answer is pretty obvious. I think I'll try out the chute. So it's a jump into the unknown, but if the alternative is certain death, it sort of clarifies, it pushes aside all the other issues and makes you focus on that. I really believe that not too far in the future, we'll look back on today and we'll scratch our heads and we'll just go, what was wrong with people? They were throwing people in the ground to be eaten by worms and bacteria, or they're incinerating them, when they could have given their loved ones a chance at living longer. Why didn't they do that?